My job is really made easier by the presentation by Rafael and by Tony, just to demonstrate the high level, the very high level, the very high technical level of the treatment of spine tumor here. So it's very easy now for me to go ahead a little bit and starting from our experience, try to understand if we have the possibility to do something better. As indeed, there is something changing. I don't understand if this is a tumor that change, or we may be something we don't do perfectly what we have to do, or we are too much confident in our experience. I don't know, but there is something that we must face, and it's better now to deal together now. So my topic now is to deal about the oncological indication to the treatment of spine tumors, and find if there is something that create a mismatch. And after a presentation from our friend, the radiotherapist and physical experience about radiotherapy, let's find some solution. Let's start with the outcome study that we are able to perform at Rizzoli Institute. We are able to collect a big number of cases just from the fact that we are old. So we have so many years working about that. And so it's relatively easy now to say that if we have to deal about chondrosarcoma, for example, in the spine, and if we succeed to perform an en-bloc resection, we can see that en-bloc resection with a wide margin allow to have a very good local and final outcome, while if the margin is violated, it means that during en-bloc resection we enter in the tumor, the result is really poor, and some of these patients will die. If we do intralesional surgery, so it means if we go against the oncological basic principle that we know, the result is very bad. As usual, tumors in the spine are the same as tumor in the limb. Nobody today would do an intralesional surgery in a tibia chondrosarcoma, but till today, you find people that in a chondrosarcoma on the spine, they do intralesional surgery with this final result, that this patient will recur and most of them will die. So just an example to show what I mean is that this case. This is one of our oldest cases, a young woman that arrived in our hospital in 91, and she was a very nice girl, and with this chondrosarcoma, and it's a case that can be treated by an en-bloc resection. At that time, we did, in all the cases, an angiography. In this specific case, the angiography showed that the Adamkiewicz, it means the artery which is drawing blood to the anterior spinal artery, was coming from the radiculomedullary artery running in the nerve root of T10. Which is the nerve root that we have to cut to perform the en-bloc resection. So at that time, we were very careful about this problem, so we discussed with the patient what we do. We do something which is really oncologically appropriate, and so we have to cut the nerve root. Cutting the nerve root reduces the blood flow to the anterior spinal artery, so the risk of paraplegia is very high. And so the patient say, no, I don't like this, I want to do sport activity. And so please do something that reduce the risk of paraplegia. So we did an intralesional excision in this case rather than to perform an en-bloc resection, which is what we now called intentional transgression to oncological principle, just to reduce the morbidity. What is the result? The result that for several years she went fine. You can see that doing sport activity, but as expected, as you have seen in the previous outcome study, after 5 years, there was a local recurrence. So at this point, there was no alternative. We said, well, we have to sit down and to decide. We have to do what is really needed. So let's do an en-bloc resection. Let's sacrifice the nerve root. Let's maybe reduce the blood flow to the cord, but we have to fulfill the oncological principle. Hopefully, there was no neurological problems. as expected, as today we say, as expected, there have been all the Tomita experience and all our clinical experience. We have never published this experience as it's really something that can create some problem, but we have done in many cases the sacrifice of the artery feeding the Adamkiewicz, and in all the cases in which we did another angiography, we found that there is another artery feeding that area, the Adamkiewicz artery. So we stopped doing angiography later on. The patient was fine, was enjoying life, she had a pregnancy, and now we have a right till our days with, you see, a 25 years follow-up without any evidence of further disease. She is happy, and there is a very good bone formation through the carbon fiber cage, which has been used anteriorly. But obviously, not all the cases are so nice. This is another case of recurrent chondrosarcoma after an oncological principle not fulfilled, as in this case, they did an intralesional excision and radiation for this chondrosarcoma. Nobody today would do the same in the tibia, but you see that even today, they do intralesional surgery in a chondrosarcoma where a blocker section could have been done. So which is the evolution, that he had a recurrence, and once more they did radiation and intralesional surgery, and finally they referred to us this patient after the second recurrence with a motor paraplegia with a very high dose of radiation already done. So what to do at this point? If we want to follow the oncological principle, there is no alternative rather than to try to do an en bloc resection, which obviously have to include four vertebrae and with the cord. And you see here we have resected the vertebra and also the canal, so the cord has been completely sacrificed, the oncological principle has been fulfilled, and you see here the reconstruction. So you see that from an oncological point of view, looks fine, but unfortunately, there is not only the oncological principle, there is also the morbidity of this kind of surgery. The patient died 5 months later for the complication which went out after this surgery. So this is the starting of my presentation. So there are the oncological principles that we have to follow, but in the decision-making process, maybe we have to consider something more. There is one more point, which is easier to understand in chordomas. Chordomas are different from chondrosarcoma. It's basically, chondrosarcoma is very hard, no? It's easy to manipulate. Chordoma is very soft, it's like a jelly. So whenever you have in your hands and you try to remove it outside from the spine, you risk to squeeze it out some part of the tumor. If this happens, finished, it will recur. So we must think of this before planning surgery. And this is a very clear demonstration. You see, this is our report about 95 cases of chordoma from a single team, which is not easy. So you see, this case had been already studied in the same way, treated in the same way by the same group of people, with myself included. And you see that in the case of en bloc resection, sorry, but today is very sensitive, and you see, whenever we did perform an en bloc resection with an apparent good margin, there were out local recurrence from 28, which is very high. Maybe we can be optimistic to say, well, many of them after 7 or 8 years, some after 10 years, so maybe we can satisfy none of these patients die, but it's not a perfect result in chondrosarcoma. And there are not so many alternatives. Here, when you see radiation, is old-type radiation. We are not yet dealing here with new kind of radiation. But the results are not really satisfying. So we can easily say that local and systemic control is positively affected by a tumor-free margin resection. But tumor-free margin resection in chordoma is very, very difficult to achieve. And so we have to consider some different situations. We have some satisfactory result indeed. That's, for example, this case, L3 chordoma with a degenerative deformity, very difficult case to perform, but the oncological principles were fulfilled, and also the biomechanical principle, so the patient is stable without so many pain, so it's not a bad result. But in some other cases, we are not satisfied at all. This is a L4 chondrosarcoma. Everything looked very nice. looks a very good local result, good margin, but look, the problem is the length of follow-up. So we have never to rely on publication about 2 years follow-up, 3 years follow-up, but look at that, 13 years follow-up looks nice, but at 14 years follow-up, there is a recurrence. So there is something that's touching, something that is wrong, something we don't understand fully. So what to do is even more difficult. Another point, sometimes we think to do a perfect surgery, but at the end it is not so perfect. So you see here, the very huge chordoma from L3, very, very huge. And you see, you can imagine how soft is the tumor that's coming out from a vertebra, squeeze it out in the psoas, and go down in the psoas like it were tuberculosis, and go down and down in the pelvis. How long down in the pelvis? I don't know. Maybe posteriorly you should think, maybe I should have to go till down to the insertion of the psoas, but becomes a very, very difficult surgeon, not able maybe to do that. But we did, we tried to do our best, but it was not enough. So the margin was not good at the distal psoas, and what happened? That exactly at the end of the distal psoas, there is a recurrence. So we can call it incidental transgression to oncological principle, something which is very difficult to avoid, however, when the tumor is so big. So we are collecting a lot of situation where there is something that we must do more. But basically, the major point is that we have dictated some criteria to perform an en bloc resection. And here you can see, now we have not enough time to describe all this situation, but these are the basic kind of en bloc resection. So we can see that when en bloc resection is feasible, we should try to do it. For example, in a case like that, it is possible to do en bloc resection by double approach. If we, in this case we do intralesional surgery, so we are a little bit at a lower level of the activity. But there are cases in which this criteria cannot be fulfilled. For example, in this case, the chordoma is all over around the dura. This patient can walk normally, it's no neurological problem. So cutting the cord in this case is not a good idea, I think. So we must find something to treat this case, but sure that it is not appropriate to the oncological principle. In some other case more, en bloc resection maybe is feasible, but morbidity is very, very high. And you can find in the literature some case of en bloc resection in cases like that, but you can recognize that, yes, you can see a very beautiful specimen, but it was a disaster from the point of view of morbidity. And so now we are at the point, and the final point of my first presentation. Maybe the combination of radiation, of surgery with radiotherapy can be a very important point in the cases that I could try to find out. And indeed, in the literature, these messages are already coming out. And some years ago, we wrote this paper together with a group, a multidisciplinary group, the Spine Oncology Study Group, now in the Knowledge Forum of EO Spine, with Charles Fisher, but there is a radiotherapist, there are oncological medical oncologists. And so the conclusion was that the combination of surgery with radiation, but at least 60 to 65 rays, that now is going even bigger, but later on our friend the radiotherapist will speak about that, is could be a good option when complete resection or intralesional margin is possible, the only possibility. The second point, very quick, as it is not so relevant as primary tumor, is metastasis. Everybody knows that the best treatment for metastasis, the only evidence-based indication in the treatment of metastasis, is a combination of surgery plus radiotherapy. This was the conclusion of Diego Carson at the meeting organized by myself and Peter Varga in Bologna some years ago, coming back to the Patchell, very famous Patchell paper about this study. And this is our flowchart in the treatment of metastasis, where radiation is always included, but always not in en bloc resection, which is such a very rare indication in metastasis. So this flowchart arrives in most of the cases to combine surgery plus radiation. So, which are the indication today of the combination of surgery and radiotherapy? In primary tumor, we have seen that sometimes we cannot do indeed an en-bloc resection. Sometimes en-bloc resection is feasible, but with too high morbidity. Some case of huge tumor, we can expect an incidental transgression during surgery, and sometimes the patient may be refused to have a nerve root cut. Maybe they say, well, remove my tumor, but I want to move my hand, and so we cannot cut the nerve root which is crossing the tumor. And in most of the cases, these problems are included in a recurrent tumor. So these are the best indications. For what concerns metastasis, this is relatively easy, as the indication is related to the sensitivity to radiation of the single histotype, but today the radiotherapists say that it depends on the aggressiveness of radiotherapy, or the tumor becomes sensitive. And over the case, the recurrent tumor is important. And which is in between our relationship between surgeons and radiotherapists? Metallic hardware. Today, what really prevents to perform the best radiation after the best possible surgery is metallic hardware. As metallic hardware interferes with the radiotherapy planning, and so the radiotherapist has problem in deciding which is the best approach. So the artifacts create a problem at this point. And another point, which is much more important for particle therapy, that this backscattering effect by the metallic art.